I'm going to talk about blockchain, obviously, and how blockchain can be used in documents in the future for security. So I'm going to start first with what is blockchain. So first, with traditional databases, you have data stored in a structured way, tables, relational databases, and it's all stored kind of in one location. You can create copies of it, but it's still just copies of the same data with a master and sub-ones. You can eliminate redundancy by linking the data through IDs and relations, but there's still data that kind of gets spread out. Again, some of the problems with that is data is stored in one place. You can have failover mechanisms, but they're all just copies. They have to sync back. And if you write to a copy, you can't really write to a copy, because then you've got to link them back to the master, and you could end up with conflicts. Another problem is data integrity. You can't keep track of these changes because the data is more dynamic, as you can update it and overwrite. And it is possible to have an audit log and keep track of the history, but it's not inherently part of the system. Another part, like I mentioned, is with race conditions. If you have multiple users editing the same value in different threads, they can theoretically write back the same value when they're not supposed to. Where you look at something here where you're just incrementing a number, thread one it increments it to 18, thread two or thread B does the same thing. Now in the database, you've written back 18 twice, when that second one really should be 19. There's no validation there. So what is a blockchain? It's a distributed database that maintains a continuous growing list of records called blocks that are secured from tampering and revisions. A block is a collection of transactions added to the chain. This makes it so you can create a type of history from the data, and they build off of one another. Because of this, you also have data security. Users can have copies of the database because it's more an open system. The users can check for security, and the majority of users decide what data is correct. So how that is implemented is each block contains a timestamp and a link to the previous block. This is important for PDFs, because now you know when things happened, and it's not stored outside of it. It's part of the system. You also can guarantee authorship and integrity by using hashes and digital signatures and cryptographic concept. Because blockchains are built off of previous records, they're inherently resistant to changes, which solves the problem with standard databases. Why is this important? It allows you for three main concepts that are kind of also integral to signing and documents. You have integrity. The document has the exact content. You know, and this is done by using hashes. Authentication, by using keys, you can prove that if I created this document and I can prove it. And non-repudiation, where he created the document and I can prove it. So this is like why, if you created this hash on October 10th, here's a transaction in the blockchain which contains the hash. I've created according to this formula from the file. This works because it's easy to compute this information. It's easy to compute the hash. The hash doesn't change because it's, or when you change the document a little bit, the hash changes very dramatically. And, yeah. So, like I mentioned previously, blockchains have a history. They change by having the timestamp and the link to the previous record. They create a type of history where when you have blocks that try to join in and link from something previously, they can kind of inherently get erased or overridden by the majority trend. So going back to hashing, hashing is turning arbitrary blocks of data into a fixed size bit string. It's used for verification of data integrity because any small change drastically changes the hash. And it's also important that it's a fingerprint for the document, but it's a one way. You can't go from a hash to the document. You go from document to the hash. And using this in blockchain is important because the hash is there to identify the document, but the actual data, any personal information, isn't stored in the blockchain. So going into encryption, when you have public and private keys, you can prove who encrypted or who signed that data. Because if you have a private key that was signed, data was encrypted with a private key, when you decrypt it with a public key, you know that it could only have been created with a private key. And this works both ways. And this is used for signing and PDFs, but also with the blockchain. So how does this relate to PDFs? Currently with PDFs and digital signing, you have certificate authorities, you have to have a timestamp server, and the big one is they can't be signed in parallel. If you send a PDF out to be signed by three different people, first person signs a document, saves it, sends it to the next. This creates a new hash and a new document, and the first one obviously doesn't have that signature. What can end up happening is you can end up with 3 to 4 different documents, have partial signatures, have full signatures, where it's all signing the same document, but now you have 4 or 5 different hashes. Blockchain can remove that need by removing signatures from the document. Because data is in the blockchain, it's a known infrastructure outside. It's automatically validated and timestamped because of the use of private and public keys. And it can be viewed by anyone. Even if the document itself or the content of it can't be, the hash is still viewable by anyone. So anyone with the document can verify this is what was signed. And again, because blockchain is separate and the data lives separately, it references that data and that document can be shared and looked up. Again, it doesn't change. Looking at kind of a high-level workflow of how this would work. A document is created, its ID or hash gets registered on the blockchain, and then Bob needs to sign the document. So he signs it, he puts his key and ID and adds the hash to the blockchain. Now Alice can look up whether or not Bob has signed it without actually receiving a document back or any type of confirmation. As soon as it's signed, instantly Alice can know whether or not that was signed. Alice can check the record on the blockchain with the ID to be able to see that. Using Bob's public key and hash, Alice can then confirm that Bob is actually the one who signed it and it's not someone else. At a high level, what's being stored is you have the ID, hash, plus the algorithm, the signature, and then fields that can be chosen by the end user. So in this case, just a couple examples, waiting for feedback, assets have been checked by customs, awaiting signature, paid, whatever needs to be used in terms of the use case for it. So one of the key concepts of the blockchain as well is the web of trust. In cryptography, a web of trust is a concept to establish the authenticity binding between the public key and its owner. Because if you send a document out to Bob to be signed, how do you know it's actually Bob's key? How does Alice know that Bob is the one who signed it? You do this by looking up the public key. So Bob can look up the public key of Alice. This is all assuming that these public keys are truly available, and you can just look them up. Or obviously Alice can give the key and say, this is my key. But again, to create this web of trust, Bob can say, okay, I've confirmed this public key belongs to Alice. Let me sign it with my private key to say I trust Alice. Now anyone who has Bob's public key can confirm Alice's identity without actually talking to Alice. And this is what creates the web of trust. It builds a graph where the nodes are connected by a trusting relationship. So this is the application built on top of this framework can decide how to handle trusted users, where in this case you can look where Tony trusts Mike, who trusts Eve. Well, now Tony can trust Eve by that nature. And this allows you to have a wide web of kind of authenticity and trust between everyone. This some an example of this where this is where what kind of looks like in a right in a current PDF where blockchain would remove this out. So in the web of trust, extensions are possible. Add a status to field, acknowledge, not acknowledge, etc. So Bob can revoke his trust, and only the most recent one is taken into account. It can also be used for interim trust, where if you want to trust a certificate for a certain amount of time, kind of how certificates work now with revocation. A couple of use cases of this that we've seen. Blockchain for documents. You can create, put a document. So in this case, like in the previous slide, looked at like a birth certificate or something like that, passport. You can sign it, put it on the blockchain, and be able to say, this belongs to me, this is my document. Share it around and use it for like authenticity, proof that it's actually yours. When you look at the blockchain, the records are distributed. As they're added, the majority is in control. So if it gets added to 51%, then it gets added to the rest, and that data is accepted on the blockchain. Another example of this is certificate of authenticity. Let's say there is a Picasso painting up for sale, or you have one. Alice is in the gallery, and the owner is John Doe. If Chuck comes up and pretends to be John Doe and submits a fake Picasso, you can verify whether or not that's real by using the hash. In this case, it's using a fake certificate because the certificate can't be found on the chain. This is done because the private and public keys don't match, doesn't encrypt the correct data. The second attempt by Chuck fails because the hashes don't correspond. The paintings aren't the same. If the paintings aren't the same, then it doesn't work, and you won't sell because it's a different document. So in the, here, John Doe is actually selling it. He offers the real one for sale. The key and the hashes match. So now the owner becomes Richard Rowe. And history shows that John Doe owned the art from January 1st until February 1st. This is used to create a history of the document, be able to track where files have gone and where they can go. Carol can jump in and say, as the insurance services, and say, hold on, let me verify this. Carol has the same information, the hash, the certificate, and it verifies it as well. In this case, alerts John and Bob about the impending sale. If it's a forgery, if it's not correct, Carol is going to monitor for that to make sure the certificate and all the information is correct, so Carol doesn't lose out on the money. Another case where we see this reused is in supply chain. When you have files that need to go between companies, invoicing and such. So in this case, Alice can send a quote request into Bob, a vendor, who can then use that and create a quote out of that, change status to quote, creates a PO that gets signed by Alice. Carol gets this PO and creates a shipment. Alice accepts it and sends the payment to Dave. This is all done kind of with the same document. You can see with the signatures. And you can keep track of everything, of how everything changes and how it goes through the flow. Another big use of this is long-term validation. currently, when you have validation, you have to go up to a server. And obviously, there's PDF support long-term validation to include that inside the PDF. One of the challenges there is obviously with certificates that revoked or expired or et cetera. It's possible with the blockchain to renew a signature to say, okay, maybe this is bad. There's an error in the hashing algorithm. There's an error in something. Let's re-sign it, and now anything previously is dead. The file never changes because the signature is all on the blockchain, so you don't have to worry about a file with an incorrect signature or something that can be exploited, because it looks to the blockchain to have that for that information. And summarize, one of the big concepts here is that one blockchain is needed. The information, and people can use it differently, but the strength is in the numbers. If separate chains, blockchains happen, nothing can be tracked. If everything's together, then it's very easy to look up that information. But all the data in the blockchain is obviously public, which is why the hashing comes into play, and is a huge part of this, where you can verify the documents are correct without actually including the information. So, thank you. Is there any questions?
Yeah. Going back to your example of the invoice going to PO, when you're sort of revalidating, adding in the new end of the blockchain, is that able to handle adding in new information into the document as well?
So yeah, you can as long as you can add in information. So in this case, you can see the document does change a little bit when it switches. As long as it links together. And in this case, yes, you can change it.
Right, so it's going to be like if I add a new page on top of it, it's got some new information. Everything below that new page has already been previously validated with the blockchain associated with that. And now the new page has a new signature on it that then validates that.
Yeah, so the signature, in this case, for signing of it, the signing happens in the blockchain.
Yeah.
The document can change a little bit as long as the information it's all linked together. So usually when you're talking about signing, it's signing the same document you're sending out to four people to be signed. In a supply chain example, obviously there is things that change where you go from a PO or a quote to an actual order or to an invoice.
Right.
So the important thing is it's linked together and it's all kind of as part of the same chain.
Okay, I was just wondering if your schema handles that situation.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Is there any other questions? Thank you.